And of course, we begin with that breaking news where in Beijing, where China's parliament has reportedly passed a controversial national security law for Hong Kong. So significant here. Full details of the legislation still haven't even been released. But state media has said it would criminalize acts of secession, subversion, and terrorism. Critics argue it could undermine the city's civil and political freedoms. We have full coverage for you. CNN's Anna Coren joins us from Hong Kong. And Stephen Jiang is in Beijing. Anna, I want to start with you in terms of the reaction, in terms of how the territory is actually taking all of this in. Because for many, it will be a stunning reversal to rights that they thought they would have for years to come.
That's right. When the British handed it back to China in 1997, I don't think anyone envisaged that China would do this. But Amnesty International came out a short time ago calling this law a weapon of repression and that this was China's way to govern Hong Kong through fear from this point forward. We've also heard from the Taiwanese government that it strongly condemns this law. And as you say, this law will now ban secession, subversion, foreign interference and terrorism. But you are talking about terrorism from within. When countries around the world have these national security laws, it is generally from attacks externally. Well, China views what has been happening here in Hong Kong as homegrown terrorism, that the protests, the people taking to the streets, calling for greater freedom, some even calling for independence. They have seen this as a threat. They have seen this as a major embarrassment. And the timing, Paula, is crucial because tomorrow is the 1st of July. Well, a year ago, protesters were storming LegCo, the Legislative Council building here in Hong Kong, and that was a huge embarrassment for the Chinese government. The 1st of July is also typically a day when activists do take to the streets and protest, calling for greater freedoms. But China has made sure that will not be happening. And if there are protests on the streets, which have been planned, that police will be able to arrest them, and potentially under this new national security law. Critics say this is the end of one country, two systems, the end of Hong Kong's autonomy, the end of Hong Kong's rule of law, which has differentiated Hong Kong from mainland China. You know, this is right. a global international hub, and many financial institutions here will be thinking twice. Interestingly, Paula, I should note that the Hong Kong stock market has actually risen with the announcement of this law. So that too is an interesting development.
It really is. There's so much to take in there in Hong Kong, but also in Beijing. Stephen Jiang joins us from there. And I have to ask you, Beijing clearly feels emboldened to do this. Why now?
Well, Paula, they're doing this now because from Beijing's perspective, this is long overdue. Remember, tomorrow marks the 23rd anniversary of Hong Kong's sovereignty returning to Beijing. And over the years, the local authorities in Hong Kong just unable to pass a national security legislation. The last time they tried was in 2003, and huge protests turned up on the streets. So the local authorities had to shelve it and really never reintroduced it. And over the years, of course, we have seen many anti-Beijing protests and demonstrations on the streets, including this latest protest movement that began last year. So from Beijing's perspective, they're seeing a growing movement in Hong Kong, growing activism, not only about pro-democracy causes, but also a growing pro-independence movement. And they, of course, have been framing all this as being instigated by Western powers, especially from Washington. That's why they're seeing this legislation being not only necessary, but also increasingly urgent to really defend their core interests in Hong Kong, that is their sovereignty and their security. But interestingly, as Anna was mentioning, this law was being discussed and voted on behind closed doors. 161 members of the National People's Congress Standing Committee, they are the ones who are voting this. And still, even many Hong Kong officials not knowing the details and the wording of this law. So this kind of lack of transparency definitely does not inspire confidence, Paula.
And certainly would be very, very concerning for protesters, obviously, in Hong Kong. I want to, just before I let you go, Stephen, talk about the international reaction. I mean, Secretary of State Mike Pompeo here in the United States tweeted just in the last hour, basically saying that the Chinese Communist Party's threats to restrict visas to U.S. citizens is just the latest example of Beijing's refusal to accept responsibility for breaking its commitment to the people of Hong Kong. But here's where it gets interesting. We will not be deterred from taking action to respond. And yet, what can they do? We have seen notes of condemnation from the EU, from of course, the United States. And yet, does Beijing believe, they clearly do not believe, that there will be any influence here over what they do in Hong Kong?
That's right. Beijing so far have brushed aside any of these concerns and criticisms, and especially from Washington. Mr. Pompeo's tweet actually was referring to the latest tit-for-tat measures and countermeasures between the two governments over Hong Kong. Not only the U.S. State Department in the U.S. has imposed visa restrictions on Chinese officials, they say responsible for the erosion of autonomy in Hong Kong. The U.S. is also ending export of defense equipment to Hong Kong, as well as military civilian dual-use technologies to the territory. And the U.S. Senate actually just passed a law aimed at punishing China and Chinese officials playing a similar role. So all these measures really have been denounced here in Beijing, and with officials here saying this kind of pressure is not going to do anything in terms of affecting the Chinese government's determination and its capability to uphold and carry out this law in Hong Kong. From their perspective, this is only going to really make them reinforce their notion that these external interference is exactly why they need this law in Hong Kong. Paula.
And Anna, it then goes over, of course, to those protesters in Hong Kong and how you believe they will react in the coming days and weeks.
We are expecting people to take to the streets tomorrow to really put a stamp on the 1st of July, and also in response to this national security law. But since COVID, Paula, you know, the police presence on the streets of Hong Kong has just been overwhelming. Protesters have not been able to get any traction. So the numbers that we witnessed last year, we just haven't seen this year. And with this national security law now in place, people will be scared to take to the streets. We've heard from Joshua Wong, who, as we know, a very high-profile democracy activist here. He has quit his party, Democisto, along with Nathan Law and Agnes Chan, other members of that party, obviously fearing what the implications are, not just for them, but for the party as well. People like Jimmy Lai, another pro-democracy activist who runs Apple Daily here, which is an opposition newspaper, online newspaper. You know, he's also very concerned as to what this means for him. Anyone who has spoken out, anyone who has shown opposition to China. We don't know if this is going to be used now retroactively. We don't know if these people could be facing life behind bars, right, as has been speculated. So real concerns, Paula, for what this is going to mean.
Yeah, I mean, the bottom line, a life sentence potentially for freedom of speech laws, which were supposed to be in force in Hong Kong for several years to come.